What's up, everyone? Welcome to my channel. I'm Ryan Becker, and every week I drop a new video where I discuss absurd issues in religion, culture, and society. This week's absurdity, secular versus sacred, is a false dichotomy. So, a cool thing came in the mail this week. Our new absurd podcast network, Face Masks. The podcast network is something that I launched in January of 2020, and if you didn't know, we have merch. So if you want to support what I do, one way to do it is by checking out and copying some merch of your own. So head to the link in the description to select from masks, which are polyester on the outside and cotton on the inside, hoodies, shirts, and more. If you enjoyed this video, I'd appreciate the normal YouTube stuff, but I'd really appreciate it if you share it with a friend that you think would enjoy it. The only way that I can grow this channel is by people like you sharing my content so that others can see it too. Now, I know what you're probably thinking. Ryan, but the two are separate. Secular is anything outside of the church. It's all the worldly stuff, the violent TV shows, the inappropriate websites, and worst of all, atheism. I disagree. While functionally, at a textbook level, yes, secular is anything outside of the church or not having anything to do with religion. But if I look at the world through a faith-based lens, I genuinely believe that the label secular is a misnomer, and that Christianity's insistence that you are either in or out is only causing harm to its mission, not furthering it. See, it's always interesting to me that Christians have always maintained that everything that we do either drives us toward God or away from God. There's this understanding that every decision that we make impacts our relationship with the divine in some way. And I would actually argue that in almost every religious worldview, there is some version of this belief. My point in this video is to demonstrate why it's so problematic for Christians, of any background or label, to try and sort the world into these two neat categories, secular and sacred. For years, we have heard leaders, parents, teachers, pastors, etc., tell Christians to be in the world and not of the world, to make sure that you don't compromise your faith by letting the secular creep in and corrupt the sacred. But what if that line is not as defined and black and white as we think? What if there is a different way to interact with the things that we witness and experience in the world that we live in? Here are some of my reasonings for why I believe we should do away fully with the separatist language that tries so hard to define between what is of God and what isn't. First and foremost, secular and sacred is internal language meant to attack things done outside the church. It's usually language meant to protect the church rather than interact with the world. This is the in the world and not of the world mentality. We feel we were given the role of protecting God's church and helping to keep it pure. That means we also cannot let these worldly influences creep in. That always seemed like a fruitless endeavor, because in the Bible I've been reading, it's God that purifies, not people. In fact, if we were able to purify anything, or even keep anything pure, well, why did we even need Jesus then? Usually, when we see this language used, it's to put something down that someone disagrees with or just doesn't like. It's used to project personal preference and subjectivity as objective truth. Through that often unintentional, but sometimes intentionally manipulative practice, those using this language can then claim that any disagreement with their personal preference is a disagreement with God's personal preference. It's not hard to see how potential problems can result from that. But not only that, it's an arrogant judgment that dismisses anything created outside of the church, so that we will only celebrate things that are sourced from within it. It assumes that simple correlation, being that something came from within the church, is what makes something sacred. It's as if we believe that the way Christians live was directly handed down to us by God, and not at all influenced by, you know, our cultures and technology and, you know, the world that we live in. Sorry to disappoint you if you thought that those hymns that you love or those Hillsong albums that you repeat were written by God himself. They weren't. Which leads to another problem. These labels lead us to erroneously conclude that something is only good if it is sourced from something good. And that's funny considering that anything a Christian or the church produces is sourced from people, which, well, we needed Jesus to even have a shot at becoming good. And if you want to counter that by saying that God created us and God is good, well, that slope gets slippery pretty much immediately. If that's true, then by definition, anything at all that a human does is good, period. Or at the very least, anything that a professed Christian does is good. And we all know for a fact that that's not true. Just because something was made by Christians doesn't mean it's better or even good at all. Another issue with the secular and sacred language is that it allows for no exceptions. When we think in these black and white labels, we don't know what to do when someone defies that either-or boundary. For example, the church had no idea how to react to Kanye West's 2019 album, Jesus is King. and many Christians still don't really know what to do with a song like Ultralight Beam, which released back in 2016. Many young adults who have grown up as Christians have no idea what to do when they hear a seemingly religious song that sounds, well, good. And then they discover that it was written by someone who isn't a Christian. And why would they know what to do? They were told that those artists who have poured countless hours and dollars into their passion and work could never create something good by the church's definition. Because the only good is that which comes from within Christianity. Secular and sacred doesn't allow for artists of any medium to actually express themselves or communicate their interest in faith or doubts with faith at all. They either have to be all in or all out, and they have to have always been in that category. But not only that, once they choose in or out, they must stay that way. Don't believe me? Once again, look at how so much of Christianity reacted to Kanye's gospel album. It's really sad too, because detractors will state that Kanye's actions since then prove that the gospel album was a deception or a lie. Journey with me for a second. If you made an album like that, and the group that you would hope would accept it rejects it and calls you a liar in the process, why in the world would you ever want to fully associate with that group? As a result, this becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. Someone creates something spiritual, we insult them and reject them wholesale, they don't ever commit to faith in any serious way, and then we say that their lack of commitment is proof of their deception rather than proof of our failure to support faith-seeking people. And if you're stuck on Kanye here, because, well, Kanye, I get it, you can go ahead and replace him with almost any artist and my general statement will ring true. The band Under Oath, who made very faith-based hardcore songs and post-hardcore songs, was largely written off by mainstream Christianity. They eventually all left Christianity, but if you hear them talking about why, yeah, their loss of belief plays a major role, but so does how they were treated by Christians and how they saw Christians behave in general. How about an artist who is a committed and professed Christian? Lecrae. The man writes about Jesus all day long, and Christians reject him because his beats are too secular and worldly. For whom? Jesus didn't decide that any of us were too secular for him to save, so what gives us the right to declare anything else that? It's depressingly frustrating to watch Christians reject things like Christmas because they have pagan origins, as if God is strong enough to redeem a person, but not really anything else. Yet we do this with art all the time. And in doing so, we often reject the artist that created it. In fact, the Bible supports the idea that we reject the artist because we reject their art. Notice that Jesus really only gets angry or lashes out when he sees people, beloved creations of God, being mistreated, neglected, and condemned by others. People are driven to create, and people usually create as a reflection of their experience. Our experience cannot always be defined by the walls in which we worship once a week, or used to, anyway. Even the most committed Christian who spends the majority of their free time engaged in the church still has some aspects of their lives either not known by or determined by their relationship with the church. We often can accept that human beings are complex and hard to fit into simple molds, but we demand that whatever human beings create must fit a narrowly defined framework or else it becomes unacceptable. When we try to force this monolithic view of artistic expression onto people, we deny them the opportunity to be, well, people. We also conform God to the very specific methods and modes of expression that we approve of, rather than recognizing God for the limitless, powerful being that he is. And all of that leads me to my major and main concern for the secular versus sacred mindset. The most dangerous aspect of the secular and sacred delineation is that the worldview that accompanies it slowly erodes our ability to identify the slow, steady movement of the Holy Spirit. A black and white view of expression, creativity, and a functional relationship and experience with God slowly degrades our ability to identify, respect, and support the spiritual journeys that people are on. By perpetuating a false dichotomy of the secular and the sacred, Christians often position themselves as the biggest obstacle that keeps those far from God from ever drawing closer to him, which is the exact opposite of what we were called to do. See, I agree that there are some people who are transformed in a singular, powerful moment, a Damascus Road-like experience like Paul had, where in one instant everything was changed. But for most of us, the work of the Spirit is slow, taking place over a large amount of time. It's whispers here and there that persuade us and call us into the right direction. So when someone like Kanye, or really any artist who has dabbled in faith-inspired expression, shows a clear demonstration of those whispers, how the church responds often determines the trajectory of their journey. If someone declares their belief in God, and we outright reject them and denounce them because they didn't get our approval before they expressed it, why in the world would they ever want to associate with us? It's so frustrating because it creates this terrible cycle of confirmation bias, this self-fulfilling prophecy I talked about earlier. Someone expresses interest in faith, Christians claim that that expression is not genuine and it won't last, the person never finds a faith community that accepts them, so they give up. And then those responsible for rejecting them beat their chests with pride because they've seen through Satan's lies, when in reality, all they did was let Satan use them to push someone away from God. Our stubborn refusal to adopt anything other than an in or out mentality causes us to reject people who are earnestly following God's call. We reject the working of the Spirit on someone's life, and in so doing, we begin to believe that God's ability and power is only expressed in methods that we approve of, or that worked on us. And by adamantly denouncing everything that the church doesn't create or do, all we are doing is trying to tell God how to do his job. Consider the parable of the wheat and the tares in Matthew 13. In this parable, Jesus tells of a man who returns to his field to find out that an enemy has sown weeds among all the good wheat that he planted. The servants ask if he wants them to go and pull the weeds. And the man says, no, because while you are pulling the weeds, you might uproot the wheat with them. Let both grow together until the harvest. Jesus made this much clear. It's not our job to find and pull out the weeds. It's God's. And he already told us who he would be delegating that responsibility to. It's not Christianity's job to protect the faith, because the Lion of Judah doesn't need protection. We got so caught up in trying to be the hero of our own faith narratives that we've usurped the judgment and hero role from God himself in order to play God by deciding who gets to be in and who is out. So it's time that we support those who exist in the in-between, that gray area of exploration between belief and unbelief. It's time that we acknowledge the journey and celebrate anyone who is on one of their own. It's time we stop trying to put ourselves in the way of God as he works to reconcile with those that he loves. It's time that we ask forgiveness for taking every opportunity to denounce anything that we didn't create ourselves. Because if we keep behaving this way, trying so hard to be known for what we are against, then we will discover that we have stopped following the God that we claim others should follow, making our own personal tastes the God that we worship. And if you're someone who is in the in-between, whether that's away from faith or toward it, I want to acknowledge that journey and say thank you for being brave enough to take it. I'm actually grateful for those who have had the courage to walk away, because it is through leaving that you have shown Christians in your sphere of influence that their behavior is not acceptable. Those who have left our churches have ironically been the biggest catalyst for change within them. I'm just sorry that we keep doing things that drive people away in the first place. Just know that even though Christians often suck at being people, there is still a God who loves you, and I hope one day you have an encounter with it that is so loud that it drowns out the negativity from those who forgot the meaning of their own encounters. For those of us still claiming that we are all in with faith, let's keep our own journeys, which many of us have had the privilege of keeping personal, in mind as we interact with those who live in the unfortunate reality that every step that they take and stumble they experience is on full display for the world to see. Let's be patient and supportive for anyone in that gray. Let's step into it with them and show them that they are loved, appreciated, and valued. Let's show them the same love that God has shown each one of us, despite our numerous faults and shortcomings. If you've made it this far, thanks for watching. Check out the description below for a link to a full-length Absurdity podcast episode on this topic, as well as links to my other shows in the Absurd Podcast Network. If you like this video, leave a thumbs up, click that subscribe button, and share this video with a friend. And so now, as always, enjoy some footage of my corgi Sugar to brighten your day.